हरे कृष्णा डिवोटीज, प्रभुजीज एंड माताजी, प्लीज एक्सेप्ट माय हम्बल ऑबिसेंसेस। ऑल गुरु सुशील प्रभुपाद, आई एम सो ग्रेटफुल फॉर दिस अपॉर्चुनिटी टू ग्लोरीफाई यू नो भगवत कथा, यू नो कृष्ण नाम, हरि नाम संकीर्तन विथ ऑल ऑफ यू डिवोटीज। दैट्स द परफेक्शन ऑफ लाइफ, वेन एवर वी कैन have this opportunity, we should very thankful to all the devotees, to the Lord, you know, and to the person who is giving us this opportunity. So I thank His Grace Ramchandra Prabhu and his team for giving me this service, and I thank you all of you to take your valuable time and come and join this Sangha. So I'm so fortunate. So now, without further ado, we will start describing today's Sangha and today's topic. The topic is the Sankirtan Yajna, and the verse that we have selected is very nice. You know, I think I can't find a verse better than this, you know. So let me tell the context of this verse. This verse is from 5th canto, chapter 19 and verse number 24. So in the 5th canto, Shukadeva Goswami is describing many things, the whole universal structure, how the universe has different islands. And in this particular chapter, he is describing some of the sub-islands of Jambudvipa. So Jambudvipa, Reva Khande, Bharatvarsha, you know, Ilavrut. So we have heard this, this sometime when we go to for some yajna or some puja, the priest speaks like that. So Jambudvip Bharat Khand is known as Ilavrut Varsh, or you know, Reva Khande. These are the different names, but Bharat Varsh is part of Jambudvip. And Shukadeva Goswami is describing the Jambudvip, and then he's describing the glories of Bharat Varsha, that how in the Bharat Varsha, in the Jambudvip, in the first part of the chapter, he describes the Kim Purusha Varsha. Now Kim Purusha Varsha is the Kim Purusha, they are the people, they are above earthly people, and they worship the Lord Ramchandra. Hanumanji is the chief among the Kim Purusha Varsha, and they are worshipping Lord Ramchandra. And then Shukadeva Goswami comes to the part of the Bharata Varsha, where, so Kim Purusha Varsha and then Bharata Varsha. So Bharata Varsha, where there is Lord Nar and Narayan is residing. And Srila Narada Muni is glorifying Nar and Narayan Muni. And along with that, he sings the glories of Bharat Varsha and the people residing in the Bharat Varsha, and where Narad Muni is speaking this particular verse. So we'll come to, at some point, we'll come to the context that how this verse is connected, and I mean the other few previous verses where all the demigods are also praising the inhabitants of Bharat Varsha, you know. And then we'll connect, of course, because this is Sankirtan Yajna, so we'll connect with the pastimes of Lord Chaitanya. So now let's start singing this verse. Nayatra Vaikuntha Katha Sudhapaga Nasadhavo Bhagavata Stadashaya Nayatrayagne Shamaka Mahotsava Suresh Loko Pinavesa Sevyata. Okay, if all of you want to sing, please. Nayatra Vaikuntha Katha Sudhapaga Nasadhavo Bhagavata Stadashaya Nayatrayagne
Shimakam Mahotsava
सुरेश लोको वेरी नाइस थैंक यू राम तुलसी प्रभु सो विल रीड द ट्रांसलेशन एंड परपर्ट इन ट्रांसलेशन परपर्ट बाय हिज डिवाइन ग्रेस अभय चरणानंद भक्ति विदान स्वामी श्री प्रभुपाद महाराज श्री प्रभुपाद की जय एनी इंटेलिजेंट पर्सन डज नॉट टेक इंटरेस्ट इन अ प्लेस इवन इन द टॉप मोस्ट प्लैनेटरी सिस्टम If the pure Ganges of topics concerning the Supreme Lord's activities does not flow there, if there are not devotees engaged in service on the banks of such a river of piety, or if there are no festivals of Sankirtan Yajna to satisfy the Lord, especially since Sankirtan Yajna is recommended in this age. So we'll read the purport. Shri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu appeared in the land of Bharatavarsha, specifically in Bengal, in the district of Nadia, where Navadvip is situated. It is therefore to be concluded, as stated by Shri Bhakti Vinod Thakur, that within this universe, this earth is the best planet. And on this planet, the land of Bharatavarsha is the best. And in the land of Bharatavarsha, Bengal is still better. And in Bengal, the district of Nadia is still better. And in Nadia, the best place is Navadvipa because Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu appeared there to inaugurate the performance of the sacrifice of chanting the Hare Krishna Mahamantra. The Shastras recommend Krishna Varanam Vishakrishnam, everybody. Sangopangastra Parshadam Yagni Sankirtana Praye Yajanti hi sumedasa. Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is always accompanied by his very confidential associates, Sri Nityananda Prabhu, Sri Gadadhar Prabhu, and Sri Advaita Prabhu, and by many devotees like Srivas Thakur. They are always engaged in chanting the name of the Lord and are always describing Lord Krishna. Therefore, this is the best among all the places in the universe. The Krishna consciousness movement is established. Is centered in Mayapur, the birth site of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So it's not a coincidence, right? We are talking about Mayapur and Mayapur Chandra Das. He has been asked to speak today, right? To give that man the great opportunity to go there and perform a constant festival of Sankirtan Yajnam. As recommended herein, Yagnesha Makha Mahotsava. And to distribute prasad to millions of hungry people hankering for spiritual emancipation. Right? This prasad is in the form of holy name as well as the prasad which is offered to the Lord. This is the mission of the Krishna consciousness movement. Chaitanya Bhagavat confirms this as follows. One should not desire to be elevated even to a place in the heavenly planetary systems if it has no propaganda to expand the glories of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. No trace of Vaishnavas, pure devotees of the Lord, and no festivals for spreading Krishna consciousness. It would be better to live perpetually cramped within the airtight bag of a mother's womb, where one can at least remember the lotus feet of the Lord, than to live in a place where there is no opportunity to remember his lotus feet. I pray not to be allowed to take birth in such a condemned place. Similarly, in Chaitanya Charitamrita, Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami says that since Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is the inaugurator of the Sankirtan movement, anyone who performs Sankirtan to please the Lord is very, very glorious. Such a person has perfect intelligence, whereas others are in the ignorance of material existence. Of all the sacrifices mentioned in the Vedic literature, the performance of Sankirtan Yajna is the best. Even the performance of 100 Ashwamedh sacrifices cannot compare to the sacrifice of Sankirtan. According to the author of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, if one compares Sankirtan Yajna to other yajnas, He is a Pashandi, an infidel, and is liable to be punished by Yamaraj. There are many Mayavadis who think that the performance of Sankirtan Yajna is a pious activity similar to the performance of the Ashwamedha Yajna and other such pious functions, but this is a Nama Aparad. Chanting of the holy name of Narayan and chanting of other names are never equal, despite what Mayavadis think. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Om Ajnana Timirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namo Namo Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prasthaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swaminaiti Namine Namaste Saraswati Devi Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Pashyat Deshatarini Jai Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Srivasadi Gaura Bhaktavanda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare. So I would like to offer my humble obeisances to all the assembled Vaishnavas. Vaishnavas are like the desire trees. They can fulfill any and all desire. I have a humble desire to purify myself and glorify Srimad Bhagavatam. So with that prayer and that mood, we'll try to discuss today's verse, today's topic, Sankirtan Yajna. Vancha Kalpatarubhyasya Kripa Sindhu Bhyevacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo. So, this verse is spoken by Srila Narada Muni. And actually, he is speaking that this verse is actually spoken by the demigods. Narada Muni is speaking to Savarni Manu. And he is saying that how the demigods are glorifying the Bharat Varsham. And this is being told by Shukadeva Goswami to Parikshit Maharaj, which in turn has been heard by Suta Goswami, and he's telling the sages in the Naimisharanya. So this is the sequence of Bhagavatam. You know, so the demigods are saying, and Narada Muni is saying that we should not stay, you know, even in the topmost planetary system, if we do not have these three things. Basically, they are interrelated. If one thing is there, obviously there are other two things will be there. But what are those three things? Where people are not discussing the topics concerning the Supreme Lord's activity. So, Bhagavan Naam Lila. In short, Bhagavatam, you know, reciting, hearing, you know, chanting Bhagavatam, reading and hearing Srimad Bhagavatam. Let's not stay at that place. Even in that place is the topmost spiritual, topmost planetary system. If there are not devotees engaged in the service on the banks of such a river, right? They're saying the pure Ganges of Krishna Lila, pure Ganges of topics of Bhagavatam. If that's not flowing, apagata, you know, they say that, you know, apaga means those, if we don't have the Bhagavan Naam, Bhagavan Lila river, the river of the river Ganges of the Bhagavat Lila. So if when the devotees are part of this, then they are constantly, if they are, don't stay at that places where the devotees are not engaged in the service of the Lord, right? If there are not devotees, so do not stay in the places where you don't find the devotees who are busy, who are engaged in serving the Lord. And the third thing, don't stay at that places where there is no Sankirtan Yajna, Yagneshamakha. You know, so this is the Yagneshamakha means the Yagneshamakha, the performance of devotional service to the Lord of sacrifice. Makha is the Yajna and Yagyesh is the Lord of sacrifice. And sacrifice for this age is the devotional service. That's why Srila Prabhupada has translated it like that. You know, yagnas meant to serve the Yagnesh. That's the actual literary meaning. But that's why we need the acharyas like Srila Prabhupada, who actually make it so clear. You know, so it is the yagyas in this age is the devotional service, the Naam Sankirtan Yajna, which satisfies the Supreme Lord. So let's not stay in those places, even if they are the topmost planetary places. They could have everything and anything, but if there is no Bhagavan Lila Shravan, or recitation, there is no Kirtan or hearing of the Shravanam and Kirtanam of the Krishna Lila. If there are no devotees who are engaged, because sometimes we see the people, you know, and you would be so amazed. It is the Bhagavatam. People are speaking Bhagavatam. But on the context of Bhagavatam, they're speaking complete nonsense. You know. So Bhagavatam has to be heard and recited among the devotees. You know, Mayavadi Bhastra Sune Hoye Sarvanash. You know, I have one other friend and we do regular Sangha, and he was saying me that he was invited to another Bhagavatam course where there are about 10,000 people, 5 to 10,000 people in Bombay, and the reciter was speaking, you know, complete nonsense. He says that, you know, the Parabrahma, the Supreme Lord, has no form. But when he comes to do some purpose on the earthly planet, he takes the form under the Maya. And he takes any form. He becomes Mother Durga. He becomes Lord Shiva. He becomes Lord Ganesha. He becomes Lord Rama, Lord Krishna. What is this nonsense? You know, what is this nonsense? You know, very clearly throughout the Bhagavatam, even from the very beginning, it is being established that the Supreme Lord is a person. His abode, his devotees, and his form, they are all eternal. They are always situated. You know? We should know that. Where is that in the Bhagavatam? You know, it is in the second canto, 9th chapter. You know, we should be able to defend this very well. So I know even it's a side track, but I will just share a briefly. So we should all know that. And I showed my friend that, you know, we should know that this is not the truth. By knowing that, you know, by knowing this, we should be always able to know the Siddhanta, you know, because I'm doing devotional service, but for what? What's the purpose? I'm doing some auspicious, pious, spiritual activity. What's the purpose? If we don't know, then, I mean, it doesn't make, or if we know something nonsense, it doesn't much make much, actually, it's harmful. So after the Lord Brahma, when he was instructed, when he was first born, he actually heard the word tapa. And then he went for 1,000 years of austerities. After 1,000 years of celestial, after 1,000 celestial years of austerity, Lord Brahma had the actual vision of the Supreme Lord. You know? So, the personality of Godhead, being thus very much satisfied with the penance of Lord Brahma, was pleased to manifest his personal abode, Vaikuntha, the supreme planet above all other. This transcendental abode of the Lord is adored by all selfless persons, free from all kinds of miseries and fear of illusory energy. Right? Then, in this, this is the further. The inhabitants of the Vaikuntha planets are described as having a glowing sky bluish complexion. Their eyes resemble lotus flowers. Their dress is of yellowish color, and their bodily features very attractive. They are just the age of growing youth. They all have four limbs, four hands. They're all nice. We have four limbs, but they have four hands. They're all nicely decorated with pearl necklaces, with ornamental medallions, and they all appear to be effulgent. Tell me, where is this formlessness? You know, some of them are effulgent like coral and diamond in complexion and have garlands on their heads, blooming like lotus flowers, and some wear earrings. The Vaikuntha planets are surrounded by various airplanes, all glowing and brilliantly situated. The airplanes belong to the great Mahatmas or devotees of the Lord. The ladies are as beautiful as lightning because of their celestial complexions. And all these combined together appear just like the sky decorated with both clouds and lightning. You know, so this is the description. This goes, this is a very clear description. This is the has been given to the first living being, Lord Brahma, even before the creation started. He, what is being described, what Brahma is going to create, is going to come into existence for some time and then will be taken away. This goes for on and on for the life of Brahma. And then Brahma also goes, I mean, if it's a devotee, he goes to the Vaikuntha planet. Otherwise, you know, this keeps going on for eternity. But that's just because for this place, the spiritual abode of the Lord is permanent. The devotees, the Lord, they are all eternal. They are individual. What to speak of, I mean, the everything over there is actually a person. You know, let me read that one verse. What the Lord Brahma actually saw that personally. The Lord was seated on his throne and was surrounded by different energies like the four. This four is the, you know, Mahatattva, and I will read that. The 16, the 5, and the 6 natural opulences, along with other insignificant energies of the temporary character. But he was the factual Supreme Lord, enjoying his own abode. So everything that we think is impersonal is person over there, right? The Lord is naturally endowed with his six opulences. Those are the six ones. Like his Shri, that's the wealth. His Shakti, that's the power. You know, he is most famous. Yasha, he is the most beautiful. That is Shri. And he is the greatest in knowledge. That's the Gyan. And he is the renouncer. Like this is the... And then other four are the Prakriti, Purusha, Mahatattva, and Ego. Then other 16 are the Panch Mahabhut. Then 5 perceptive sense organ. Then 5 working sense organ and the mind, right? And then the 5 other thing include is the 5 subjects of the 5 sense objects. And so all these things are personified, situated at the feet of the lotus feet. And then what we think is so great about this yogic siddhis, they are considered insignificant opulence, but they are also reality. They are not something an imagination. They are also there, those insignificant opulences, anima, mahima, garima, all these yogis, they achieve that. They are also there at the lotus feet of the Lord. Everything is there in their personal form. Where is this impersonalization comes? You know, this is something, because people, there are two things. Either they are behind pleasing the audience. The audience has million gods, and there's those 10,000 people has 10,000 opinions. They want to please them, or they don't know the truth. You know, but in either case, they are doing disservice. We have to be very careful. Srila Prabhupada, throughout the Bhagavatam, he quotes that this Bhagavatam has to be recited, has to be studied among the devotees. And then the third thing, if there is no festival of Sankirtan Yajna, people, let's not go there. So, coming back to the purport, we know this verse. This is a very famous verse, and how the Lord is being glorified. So, I believe we go up to 9:30, right? And then we'll have some time for question answer or discussion. Ramtosi Prabhu?
Yes,
Prabhu, right? So I'll try to kind of summarize the topic by then. So then Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, this is so amazing. This one sentence, this earth is the best, the topmost planet in the whole creation. We are so much, enamored. We are so much wow. This celestial kind of opulence, heavenly opulence. Heavenly opulence. Think of living, millions of years, and there is no old age, and there is no disease. What is that? There is disease in the form of anxiety is there also. That's not free. And we'll come to that right now. But people live youthful life for millions of years. But even still, Bhaktivinoda Thakur, and not only Bhaktivinoda Thakur, all the Mahajans, all the sages, all the demigods, they unison this thing, that earth is the best planet. And among the earth, Bharatvarsh. So how fortunate we are. Somehow, either we are born or we have come in contact with that culture, that spiritual, the spiritual embassy of the universe. We have been connected with that. And then even among that, the Bengal and Nadia and Mayapur, that's the epicenter of the spiritual energy. Spiritual kind of, we can say, yes, spiritual is the epicenter of the Mayapur and Nadia. That is where Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu appeared and he started the Sankirtan Yajna, right? Then we have this quote, these two quotes from Chaitanya Bhagavat. And so I was trying to find out those actual verses from Chaitanya Bhagavat, that where is that? And I couldn't find out that one. But then I came across something else, which is so glorious. That how this Sankirtan Yajna is so glorious. We all know the pastimes of Jagai and Madai. How Jagai and Madai, Lord Nityananda and Haridas Thakur approach Jagai and Madai. And then Jagai Madai becomes actually very, very aggressive. And he actually assaults the Supreme Lord. He actually hits the Lord with a stone. And the Lord's, the Sachinananda, the Vigra, his divine body actually gets this trauma. Obviously nothing can hurt Lord, but he is here in the pastimes. They bought the Supreme Lord. They are in the disguise of the devotees. So they act completely humbly. And guess what? The Lord Chaitanya appears instantly on the scene. And he wants to kill both the brothers. The Sudarshan Chakra appears on the scene. And somehow, Nityananda Thakur is begging that, please, Lord, this is not the incarnation that you are going to kill everyone. If they are offensive, then who will be spared? And then he says, okay, look at this Jagai. He actually saved me. Then, having heard that, Lord Chaitanya embraces Jagai. And then Madhai thinks, what is this? What of us, we are from the same nonsense, breed. How is he is getting such a favor? He sees the supreme effulgent form of Lord Chaitanya, having Sudarshan Chakra in his hand. So he instantly, everything becomes clear like day and night. And he also begs for the forgiveness. And Lord Nityananda, actually recommends the Lord. He actually asks for forgiveness from Lord Nityananda, and Lord Nityananda actually delivers both of them. So after this incident, actually the entire 330 million, all the demigods, they're witnessing this. And everybody's so much kind of thinking, what's happening? You know, what's happening? Then Lord Shivaji and Brahmaji and Naraji and everybody's in ecstasy dancing. And they're going back to their respective places. But what happened to Yamaraj? Yamaraj actually, when he heard, actually out of ecstasy, he became unconscious. You know, Yamaraj became so much unconscious. So he became so unconscious that because he has never heard such kind of magnanimity, such karuna. So Yamaraj became, then all the demigods, they realized and they came back, and seeing that that Yamaraj is actually unconscious, they started singing the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. And then Yamaraj comes back to the consciousness back. And then from there onwards, Yamaraj actually inquires that what's going on? How did this, tell me what are the, because he was the in charge. You know, he is the in charge of the people who are being punished. You know, so he asked his assistant Chitragupta that what happened to here? You know, please tell everybody how sinful these people were. Then Chitragupta is describing this glorious pastimes. You know, he's saying that my dear Lord, you know, what should I say about these people? They're so sinful that our messengers are constantly busy bringing their news of their sins. And Chitragupta said that the associates who are writing this, they are so much terrified that they will beat those messengers. That why are you bringing such nonsense news all the time? Then those messengers said, why you are beating us? You know, right? Because right, why are, so because they are saying, because you are bringing the news, we have to write. If we don't write, then we would be punished. You know, this how this universal system is being governed. We can't imagine, we can't fathom, you know. So then these people are saying that, you know, after writing this, we actually create a mountain for their sinful actions. You know, and we are also crying. We are also terrified that how much time these people would have to spend into the hellish planets. You know, so, but Mahaprabhu, in a fraction of a second, he actually removed all their power, all their sins. So what should we do with this mountain of sins? You know, so such is the glory. I mean, this pastimes, this how these acharyas, they write it. You know, we have heard this many times, but I personally read it for the first time, that how Yamaraj became unconscious and how all the demigods, they had this, you know, they were singing the glories of Lord Chaitanya for the, you know, years to come. So after that, in the purport, Srila Prabhupada is mentioning about a quote from Chaitanya Charitamrita. And that I was able to find out that one very well, because we have the access to the Vedabase. So where is that? That is from the Adi Lila, I believe Adi Lila, and chapter number, yes, Adi Lila, chapter number 3. So here is those verse. Seita sumeda ar kubuddhi sansara sarva yagna haite krishna nama yagna sar, right? Seita sumedha ar kubuddhi sansara sarva yagna haite krishna nama yagna sar. Such a person is truly intelligent. Others who have but a poor fund of knowledge must endure the cycle of repeated birth and death. Of all sacrificial performances, the chanting of the Lord's holy name is the most sublime. You know, Now, this is being described across the board in all scriptures. It is in the Bhagavad Gita also. I'm sure some of you can help me. Where is that in the Bhagavad Gita? Where Lord Krishna says that I am the Yagnanam Japa Yagnosmi. Right? Or Kirtan is the best. I think in the chapter 10, Bhagavad Gita chapter 10, verse number 25. So Krishna is saying in the Bhagavad Gita also, people sometimes ask us, right? Hey, you people, Hare Krishna, all the time you are chanting singing and chanting. Show me where is in the Bhagavad Gita. Yes, my dear, it is in the Bhagavad Gita. You know, Maharshinam Bhruguharam Giramasme Kamaksharam. You know, then I think that the Yagnanam Japayagnosmi Tavaranam Himalaya. So among all the yagyas, I am the Japa Yagya. So here, then in the next verse, it is said that Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is the father and inaugurator of the Sankirtana movement. One who worships him by sacrificing his life, money, intelligence and words for the Sankirtana movement is recognized by the Lord and endowed with his blessings. All others may be said to be foolish. For all of sacrifices in which a man may apply his energy, a sacrifice made for the Sankirtan movement is the most glorious. Then this is the one Srila Prabhupada is mentioning in his purport. Koti Ashwamegha Eka Krishna Nama Sama Jai Jai Kahe Sepa Sandi Dande Tare Yama Koti Ashwamegha Eka Krishna Nama Sama Jai kahe se paasandi dande tare yam. So one who says that 10 million, koti means 1 crore. We are Indians, we know crore. Like 10 million ashramic sacrifices are equal to the chanting of the holy name of Lord Krishna is undoubtedly an atheist. Right? Just be careful. You know, when we glorify sometime, we have to know that we can glorify. This is beyond our capacity to glorify. Right? He's short. So even while glorifying, we have to be careful that we are not minimizing the glories of the holy name. Right? So we should do it only among the devotees. We shouldn't glorify the holy name among the non-devotees. Because when we glorify, and if they think, oh, this is so much exaggeration, we indirectly are involved in the offense. So chant with them, give them the holy name, you know, give them prasadam, discuss them the lila and whatnot, but don't discuss the glories of the holy name. Right? Now here, let's look at he's sure to be punished by Yamaraj. In the list of the 10 kinds of offenses in chanting the holy name of the Supreme Lord, Sri Krishna, the 8th offense is Dharma Vrata Yuga Yuga Hutadi Sarva Shubha Kriya Samyam Api Pramada. One should never consider the chanting of the holy name of Godhead equals to pious activities like giving charity to brahmanas or saintly persons, opening charitable educational institutions, distributing free food, and so on and so on. The results of pious activities do not equal the results of chanting the holy name. Now guess what? We think if not equal, would it come up to some part? You know, again, that's an offense. What could you compare to unlimited, you know, infinite? What could you compare to that? So this is another verse from the Shastras. Go koti danam grahane khagasya prayaga gango dakakalpavasa yagne yutamme rusuvarna danam govinda kirte nasamam shatansa. Everybody together, please chant. Go koti danam grahane khagasya prayaga gango dakakalpavasa yagne yutamme rusuvarna danam govinda kirte nasamam shatansha. Right? Even if one distributes 10 million cows in charity during an eclipse of the sun, lives at the confluence of the Ganges and Yamuna, or Kalpavasa, actually is kalpa. The one kalpa is equal to one day of Brahma, which is equal to, 4,320 million years. Or gives a mountain of gold in sacrifice to the Brahmanas. He does not earn 100th part of the merit derived from chanting Hare Krishna. So this is very appropriate. Nothing comes closer to any merits of chanting Hare Krishna. In other words, one who accepts the chanting of Hare Krishna to be some kind of pious activity is completely misled. Of course, it is pious, but the real fact is that Krishna and his name, being transcendental, are far above all mundane pious activity. Pious activity is on the material platform, but chanting of the holy name of Krishna is completely on the spiritual plane. Therefore, although Pashandis do not understand this, pious activities can never compare to the chanting of the holy name. Now, this is such an important sentence. Pious activities on the material platform is on the material platform. But chanting of the holy name of Krishna is completely on the spiritual plane. Even a slightest effort to do the devotional service, even chanting very much, it's called Nama Bhas, chanting just the name, but with no connection. Chanting even with offense, is everything is on the spiritual plane. Once we chant, we actually open our spiritual account. Then we are, whatever purpose we are chanting, but Krishna takes this as form of our consent to intervene. We are giving Krishna permission to intervene in our life. Krishna takes that as a signed contract that, okay, now he has to come back. Once we start chanting, actually our journey back to home starts. Even with chanting with an offense, even with chanting with the Nama Bhas, by whatsoever anything. So there is no, we can't glorify the chanting enough. We can't really fathom the importance of chanting. So this was here. Now, here, in this part, we should Sankirtan Yajna, So, having taken birth in the human life, because when we go to this chapter, this chapter 19, these demigods are actually describing that how fortunate is these people of the earth, how fortunate is our birth, So here, this is the description of Bharatvarsha, right? The people who take birth in this tract of land are divided according to the qualities of material nature, the modes of goodness and passion and ignorance. Some of them are born as exalted personalities, some are ordinary human beings, and some are extremely abominable. For in the Bharatvarsha, one takes birth exactly according to one's past karma. If one's position is ascertained by a bona fide spiritual master and one is properly trained to engage in the service of the Lord Vishnu according to the four social divisions and the four spiritual divisions, one's life becomes perfect. After many, many births, when the results of one's pious activities mature, one gets an opportunity to associate with pure devotees. This is, now they are talking about us. We have the fortune of seeing the devotees, right? And then one is able to cut the knot of bondage to ignorance, which bound him because of varied fruitive activities. As a result of associating with devotees, one gradually renders service to Lord Vasudeva, who is transcendental, free from attachment to the material world, beyond the mind and words, and independent of everything else. That bhakti yoga, devotional service to Lord Vasudeva, is the real path of liberation. Since the human form of the life is the sublime position for spiritual realization, all the demigods in heaven speak in this way. Srila Narad Muni is speaking to Shravani Manu, Savarni Manu. How wonderful it is for these human beings to have been born in the land of Bharatvarsha. We must appreciate these words. You know, this belongs to us. They must have executed pious acts of austerities in the past, or this supreme personality of God must have been pleased with them. Otherwise, how could they engage in devotional service in so many ways? We demigods can only aspire to achieve human birth in Bharatvarsha to execute devotional service. But these human beings are already engaged there. The demigods continue. After performing the very difficult task of executing Vedic ritualistic sacrifices, undergoing austerities, observing vows and giving charity, we have achieved this position as inhabitants of the heavenly planets. But what is the value of this achievement? What's the value of, even if it is not valuable to achieve the heavenly planet, what is the value of achieving some material opulence on this earthly planet, which is so temporary and flickering, right? But here, we are certainly very engaged in material sense gratification. And therefore, we can hardly remember the lotus feet of Lord Narayan. This is very true. When we are so materially opulent, very few, you know, so much fortunate people, they can take up the devotional service. When we are so much powerful, so much, you know, if someone is celebrity, has a fame and power and wealth and so on, practically it's impossible. You know, indeed, because of our excessive sense gratification, we have almost forgotten his lotus feet. A short life in the land of Bharatvarsha is preferable to a life achieved in Brahmaloka for millions and billions of years. Because even if one is elevated to Brahmaloka, he must return to repeated birth and death. You know, we are, see, Bhagavatam gives us the real perspective in the life. Brahmaloka, we can't imagine 311 trillion and 40 billion years. If we live 5 years more, we will be very happy, right? If in our lifespan, at some point we think, okay, Lord, give me just 1 year, 1 month, you know, 1 day. What to speak of 311 trillion and 40 billion years, right? So that, in spite of that life, if we have to go through birth and death, what's the point? What's the point wasting time here in making the material progress only? It's not like that we should not strive for material progress, but the purpose should be to serve my Lord, not for my own sense gratification, because there is no limit to it. I have no idea. Actually, I have done everything, all of those things, whatever is said, we have gone through it, but still I haven't realized there is no end of it, right? Also, there is no end to it. Tell me which sense gratification, which sense enjoyment gives us the satisfaction so that we don't have any more desire. There is never such a thing. You put the ghee in the fire and fire subsides. You keep pouring ghee and wood in the fire and you think the fire is going to subside. There is no such thing. There is no such thing. So although life in Bharatvarsha, in a lower planetary system compared to the Brahmaloka, right? We are in a much lower planetary system and life is very short. One who lives there can elevate himself to full Krishna consciousness and achieve the highest perfection, even in this short life, by fully surrendering unto the lotus feet of the Lord. Bhajava Sudevam. You know, thus one attains Vaikuntha Loka, where there is neither anxiety nor repeated birth in a material body. And then is the verse, current verse that we are. So I just want to summarize. There's so much material. Our whole Bhagavad Gita and Bhagavatam and Chaitanya Charitamrita is nothing but the glorification of holy name. You know, there is nothing, nothing but But the, you know, the chanting of the Lord's name, pastimes, you know, and then the, his form and his paraphernalia and his devotees. That's whole and his own words. That is the sum and substance in the Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavatam, and Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita. So the understanding is that, you know, how is this Sankirtan Yajna? How are we going to take it? You know, having taken birth in this place. Now it's no more, after reading this, we should always feel so much gratitude, right? Always, we should always feel so much sense of, you know, and like a sense of, you know, like a, the, I would say, this satisfaction that yes, you know, finally I have somehow my Lord has given me this opportunity. Why? Like having been born in the Bharatvarsha and then having come in contact with the devotees, right? Now what is my ultimate, like what should I do now? You know, I'm 30, 40, 50, 60 years, or I have somebody like Yogi here, you know, who's there in their childhood years. What should be the goal and mission of my life? What should be the motto? How should I live now? Now, having known this, that I am at the best place with the best opportunity, best possible situation. How should I utilize it? See, we start the devotional service, you know, most of us like feeling being frustrated with the suffering of this world, which is absolutely very, very, very kind of a likely reason for many of us to take it. Many of us wants to make some progress, and that's why we take up the devotional service. You know, some of us are very curious, somewhat frustrated. What is this going all about? You know, why? So many questions, and that's why we take up the devotional service. But that's just the beginning. For whatever reason, when we take the shelter of the Supreme Lord, he's so much, you know, like a lovingly and so carefully, he actually nourishes our devotion. You know, he helps us if he may. Many times he fulfills our material desires. Many times he fulfills our material ambitions. But only to make sure that we make further progress in the spiritual journey in his service, right? So if we somehow get stuck to that point, he could become like a loving parent who is fulfilling all your designs. He can turn or she can turn into a very, in the next moment, very strict, very much kind of a fierce, because if we keep asking only the foolish things. So but at least we start the journey from there. Then we come to an understanding that yes, you know, getting out of this is the beginning. Now, what is the next? You know, what is the next? That somehow I should develop the desire to serve my Lord. Somehow I should develop the spontaneous loving sentiments. Not that I am doing this because I'm forced to do it by the circumstances. And that's why I'm doing as a part of my obligations. That's all right. And that's very much, very much welcome in the beginning. But at some point, we should go into the spontaneous loving devotion. So from devotional services, the rules and regulation, we go to the devotional spontaneous loving devotion. And at that time, you know, what is the most important thing? You know, even throughout this journey, the most important thing is the association of the devotees. And the Sankirtan Yajna means with the devotees. Then as we desire to serve the Lord, as we desire to have that spontaneous loving attraction, what does it mean to serve someone? What does it mean to love someone? How could I do what you want? What's your priority? You know, ultimately, it comes to the, like a Premanand, we have the ecstasy of falling in love with Lord. That's Premanand. And higher than Premanand is this Sevanand. You know, in order to serve you, I would not let anything interfere, even on my own ecstasy. How could I serve you selflessly? You know, that should be our motive. We should come to that platform. You know, that's the, what is the mission of my Lord? Why did Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. This is the best place in the universe, because out of in the entire universe, he came to this particular place. What is his mission? How could I be part of his mission? You know, I could be the tiniest living being. You know, it's not my ability. What's the desire of my Lord? How can I serve him? How can I please him? That should be my motto. That Sankirtan should go all the day. Krishna is saying that, Satatam Kirtayanto Maam. You know, Tesham Satat Yukta Naam. You know, that's Satatam, Ananya Manaso. How could I come to that platform? You know, wherever we are, each one of us has to individually introspect us daily. Bhaktivinoda Thakur recommends every Ekadashi. But at least every day, once few minutes, we should introspect ourselves. Where am I? Am I in service to the Lord? Or am I still serving my mental whims? Am I serving so-called myself, which is made up of this flesh and mind and ego? Or am I in service to the Lord? You know, so it starts with our sincere sadhana. When we do that, if we sincerely beg for that, you know, even to serve the Lord, it's like, tell me, you and me want to be the personal assistant to the prime minister or presidents or governors or mayor, anything would work. You know, anything would work. A senator or MP, MA, MLA, anything would work. Who am I, right? We want to do that. Who would hire me? Tell me. And so if we want to assist the Supreme Lord, we want to beg the service from him, what do we really need? That sincere, that intense desire, we have to come up with that. Every morning we wake up and we chant, my dear Lord, please, please, please engage me in your service. You know, we have to do that. And then when we do this sincerity, Krishna actually gives us the taste of his service. You know, the journey begins right there. You know, he's the Supreme Lord. How can he take the service from you and not reciprocate? You know, he does it so wonderfully, so you never want to stop it. Your sincere sadhana continues throughout the day, every day, and throughout the life. And what is there for you or for me? Anyone who has only one motto, how can I serve you? You know, so this, we have to, our sincere sadhana would actually allow us to serve him. You know, chanting is the best form of the service. But when we distribute it to others, that goes to they say better and more better and the best, right? You know, guhyatar, guhyatamam, guhyatamam, right? There is a more and more and more. Chanting is the perfection. But what is more perfection? Which we do with the other devotees. We try to distribute it. We put all our efforts. We thinking that, you know, this is my Lord's desires. I'm going to do it. So, you know, I mean, there's so much more we can say, but I want to conclude over here that let me focus in my sadhana so seriously, so that someday I can really serve you with all my heart. I'm doing right now because I have been told I have no other option. I'm so much terrified. I'm so much disturbed. You know, I want so many things. That's why I'm doing it. I'm doing it as an obligation. Let me come to the platform of spontaneous loving. Let me come to the platform of serving you. Let me come to that platform where I never forget you. Granthraj, Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai. Srila Prabhupada ki jai.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Prabhu. Thank you for a wonderful talk you gave, from different reference to Shastra, proving the point that, like, you know, how Sankirtan is the main essence of our scriptures. And the aspect of, like, you know, the personal form of the Lord, like, you know, how we are deviated. Thank you again for proving that point. So before that, I just want to make some announcement. So Hare Krishna, everyone. So we have started to create this calendar. First thing I want to add. So as every Wednesday we have program, so this Sunday we have His Grace Philip Pradipa Prabhu speaking in our center. please make sure to join. Our new timing in our center is 4:30 p.m. We want everybody come in time so that we can really have the whole joy of the whole entire Sunday program, releasing the kirtans and everything. So please try to join in time on Sundays. So, and we have a special speaker, as I said, and next Vandya Sangha again we'll have. And our main event festival is coming, Itandru Tridosi. So please join this in the new location. It's 156 Forest Avenue. It's the same street. Don't miss that. So it will be starting from 6 p.m. It is on 2nd February, Thursday. So if any devotees would like to sponsor, please do that. It's $101. And like as we know, we have every Bhakti Vrikshas, different locations, and devotee wants to join the Bhakti Vrikshas, please connect here. Also, Bhagavad Gita reading every day from 12 p.m. from Monday to Friday, 12 p.m. to 12:15 p.m. If you want to join, you can find this opportunity to read Bhagavad Gita every day. And chanting, daily chanting in the morning, as Prabhuji was pointing out regarding sadhana and, you know, focusing on chanting the holy name. So these are the timings every morning, 6 a.m. to 8 a.m. You can join anytime and drop anytime. And even if you like to lead the Japa call, like, you know, you can definitely connect with Jayadavati Mataji on this. And now we have started a new session called ISKCON calendar. So you can actually, what we are trying to do is organize our entire ISKCON events. Slowly we'll be updating it. But you will see all our Vaishnava calendar dates over here. And if you like, you know, all the Ekadashis, all the fast break, you know, you can see the fast Ekadashi, the what is the break time, everything you can see. You can actually even add in the Google Calendar, do that. And every Sunday program, like for example, like these are our events that is happening with the callers. You can see it has all details, like, you know, what is the schedule, where is going to happen. For example, now Nityananda Tridosi is going to happen. You can see 6 p.m. onwards. You can find the locations, all details we can update here, like that. You can see the timing and everything. So we will be updating it so we can have all our events and programs updated here in the calendar. So this is one of the good features that we are adding. We added sites of life. Please try to utilize it. And also please let us know, like if any suggestions, people can let us know, like, you know, what any things they would like to have it, so we can add those features there. So if you have any questions and comments, please go ahead. So before any devotees is thinking, so just want to add a question. Prabhu, like we do definitely talk as chanting your holy name, right? So much focus, especially in our Gaudi Parampara, right? But what about like other sampradayas? Like, you know, how much they're focusing in chanting your holy name as we do? Because we see, like, especially my personal observation is that society, especially Sanskrit, Gaudi Parampara is much more focused in Sankirtan. Like, you know, distributing the holy name, chanting the holy name, you know, making that as in sadhana. And when we take initiation, we take a vow, you know, we want to have especially, like, you know, at least minimum 16 hours of chanting. You know, do a certain regulation to make sure that we are actually chanting holy name of the Lord. Right? If we're keeping that. But have you have any idea, like, what are other sampradayas, like, you know, doing in terms of, like, you know, this aspect of chanting of holy name?
Thank you, Ramdas Prabhu. This is a very wonderful point. And actually, the holy name is actually glorified in every scripture. You know, every scripture, every sampradaya. I mean, we can enumerate all many Puranas and many. I see the Ramayana. Lord Shiva is saying, Uma Satakahume Anubhava Apana Sacha Hari Bhajan Jagata Sabha Sapana. You know, and throughout the Ramayana, even Valmiki Ramayana or Tulsidas Ramayana, Tulsidas Jikrut Ramayana, holy name has been glorified throughout that. You know, holy name has been glorified in all these scriptures because it gives the topmost spiritual benefit to the most undeserved person, which is such an inconceivable, you know, sanyog. In this world, right, when we have something, then it goes to only very qualified people, right? You want to buy a house, $1 million, then, I mean, you want to buy a house on a beach, or you want to buy on the Hollywood Avenue or whatnot, you obviously need more and more money. So achieving the supremely beneficial, I mean, supremely perfectional stage, we must need the people most qualified. But this is the mercy of the holy name, that it actually involves the most unqualified people, most lowly people. So, I mean, there are across the parampara, any Vaishnava sampradaya, everywhere, the holy name of the Lord, you know, Lord Ramanujacharya, he was given the name, holy name, and then he was instructed not to distribute to anyone. You know, he said that he was given that after so much of his personal austerities. He was tasted for years and years. And then he was at the time of the giving the initiation of this, I mean, holy name ceremony, he was instructed very heavily that if you do not follow this, and if you do not give to the qualified people, you would go to the, he would live in the hell forever. But then he said that this holy name is so powerful that anybody will be delivered. So, you know, as much as, you know, pure he is, that last part, I mean, stick to his heart. So instantly after getting initiation, he's going to the top of the temple and he's giving to everyone. So his guru is so furious. Then he goes and sees the Gurudev and he says, Guru is so much angry. And he says, my dear Lord, you know, let it be the case. You know, I will go into the hell. But all those people will be delivered, right? As you said, how not the words from your mouth not be true? And looking at this compassion, actually this Srila Gurudev was so happy in the heart. You know, his anger was completely external. So this is the mood. Like any parampara, any Vaishnava sampradaya, we know there is the Pushti Margi, they chant Shri Krishna, Sharanam Mamo, you know. So there are so many sampradayas. All the sampradayas, they emphasize on chanting of the holy name, Prabhu. I mean, there is so much kind of a list and compilation of shastras. We can discuss that, how all the different shastras, they glorify the holy name.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Prabhu. Anyone of you have any other questions? Anybody else? I don't think anyone has any questions. So again, thank you. So again, Nimai Gaurana Prabhu Prabhu has the questions. So please go ahead, Prabhu.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu. Thank you, Prabhuji, for enlightening today. Just based upon like when we are out for the preaching or like when we do counseling, for both for the neophyte devotee and then potential bhaktas and those who are following all principles. So it happens like now we have kirtan and japa, two different things are there. But it so happened like few are more or interested into the kirtan thing, and then when they're becoming potential bhaktas, their question is like, if kirtan, like taking holy name in Kali Yuga is what is deliverance. So why then japa is required? And then even though if we ask them to do japa, like they are just finished the rounds and then they are more or motivated to the kirtan part. So how we can understand this part, Prabhu?
So Prabhu, yeah, this is a very wonderful point. Prabhu, if you don't mind, you can turn on camera. So we can just connect. But if you don't mind, that's okay. So
actually I'm outside. So
no problem. So I think the Sankirtan, Srila Jiva Goswami is saying, that's the topmost of worship. You know, Sankirtan means all of our hearts coming and praying together. You know, when I'm doing japa, it's my own prayers. You know, my own prayers. In a way, it's a very personal meeting. You know, but with Sankirtan, all of us, I mean, chanting, all of us begging together. So it is so much more powerful. It is the supreme. Lord Chaitanya, it also says, Sankirtana, Yagne Yagne is sankirtane. Sankirtan means the kirtan together. Of course, that is the highest form of the worship. But how can we do it all the time? Each one of us has to work. Each one of us are on kind of, we live a kind of a far from temple. We, even if we have a home temple, all of us cannot be at the home. The children have to go to school. And we all have to do our obligation duties and obligations and duties. Whenever we get an opportunity, we should do the sankirtan. Sankirtan is not just the chanting of the holy name. It can be glorifying the Lord, talking to somebody about Krishna, reading Srimad Bhagavatam with the devotees. You know, that's all sankirtan. It's a name, fame, pastimes, paraphernalia, and activities. Everything is sankirtan. Naam sankirtan, lila sankirtan, rupa sankirtan, gun sankirtan. So everywhere. So if we do this among the devotees, or if we, because in a way, everybody is a prospective devotee. It's a matter of time. Like, how the George Harrison is saying in the beginning, everybody is looking for Krishna, whether they know it or don't know. That's the side question. But everybody is in that pursuit. Krishna is saying that also, that everything falls within my purview. Nothing is outside me. Ye yathamam prapadyante. People think that I don't follow Krishna, or I don't believe in God, but they are still controlled by his energy, external energy. So everybody is a potential devotee. So when we do that sankirtan with them, that is definitely more glorified. Srila Prabhupada, when I was searching that, he was saying that, and I can share that quote in our group. He said that, we should, all the devotees, all ISKCON devotees, what should they do? They should read 2 hours of Bhagavatam together, congregational reading. And they should chant their japa. And then rest of the time, do sankirtan. That's what he's saying. That go outside and do the kirtan. So there is no kind of contradiction over here. If somebody likes one or the other way, that is so great. But if they can do it every day, if they live in such a setup where they can do sankirtan every day, all time, that's great. I mean, practically speaking, none of us have that much kind of, we are not that fortunate to that we can do 24 hours sankirtan. So doing the japa, we can say that it is our own personal meeting with Krishna. We must take that opportunity. We meet him in a group, but we should try to cultivate that also. We should try to cultivate that sambandha. We must beg for that personal service, personal relationship. What's my personal service to you? We and each one of us have our own unique set of the problems or questions, or we are at the unique stage of life. We should bring it to our Lord. It's our one-on-one meeting with the Lord. So it's a very precious also. We should never miss that opportunity. We should never underestimate that. We devotees should always have that kind of, we should develop such mood that we are never alone. We are never bored. People feel, I don't have anything to do. I'm bored. We should come to that platform of our own self. But that, yes, talking to the mass, to the people in general, we should tell them this is a very important, that you have a personal connection with the Lord. You just don't call somebody that when you need. That's not, a loving friend or loving father, mother. They wouldn't deny or reject you, but that's not very good. But if you are in connection with every day, the other person feels the more pressure that no matter what, my friend tries to call me every day, no matter what his mind status and what his, situation is. So we say that's so important that we make that connection. So I also try that when I see new people, and after a while we say, okay, now we become friends. If someday I am on the road stranded, you would think, okay, let's see, go this Prabhu or this uncle or this gentleman, this sir or whatever, he was talking to me. Now he's in trouble. Even with this slight kind of connection, most people will incline to come and help each other. Or, hopefully we do that, but then think about if we doing the same thing every day with Krishna, how much he will, feel obliged to come to your rescue. So it's important that you make a personal connection with Krishna. So Prabhu, if anyone else has a kind of a, please share your realizations and experiences that how do we pass this message across the board. Karuna, Nimai Prabhu, are you there?
Yes, Shishru. Thank you, Prabhu. It was like really helpful for me. Like, really thank you for that.
Thank you. Thank you.
Anybody else? Thank you. I think everyone is clear. Thank you so much, Mahavishnu Prabhu, for your wonderful time. So we will all see next week again on this coming Sunday. We'll meet everyone. So Vancha Kalpataru Vyascha Kripasam Divyevacha Patitanam Pavanibhyo Vishnabhibhyo Namo Namo Nandagodi Vaishnavindaki Jai Shri Prabhupadaki Jai.
Thank you so much, everybody. Thank you. Hare Krishna Prabhu. Thank you.